And welcome everybody here on Twitch chat and everybody on YouTube who's watching this video later on for our next segment of our Core Set 2020 set review. Hawkeye's trying to get my tea that I have over here. We have green that's coming up next. We've gone through white, blue, black, and red so far. So now it's to green. So what we're doing here is we are rating all the cards in a standard grade. Sorry, Hawkeye's cracking me up. So we're grading these based on standard play, like how much play that we think that they will see in that format, the format that we always play on Arena, you know, which is standard. Going with the grades, going with the American grading scale system, A through F, like the school grade system. If you want to see more about that, I read through that grading system on the white video, which was the first video. Hope you saw that. Also, you can, if you're just checking out this video, you can click below in the info panel, or like in the video description. There we go. That's the words. There's a link to the spreadsheet with all the grades and the grading scale there. All right. So one thing I'm going to go ahead and say about the grades, though, with A through F, Fs are rares and mythics that we think should see no play at all in standard. And there's also a limited rating, though, as well. So there's an L for limited rating. And that's for commons and uncommons that really shouldn't see any standard play there. So that's the difference there. All right, Barkhide Troll is our first card. It is green, green for a 2/2, and it enters the battlefield with a 1/1 counter on it. So it's a 3/3. And you can pay one, remove a 1/1 counter from Barkhide Troll, and it gains hexproof until end of turn. Not a bad card. 2-mana 3/3 is certainly reasonable. I kind of compare this to like Thorn Lieutenant that we see in standard some. That's a 2-mana 2/3 that, you know, whenever it's targeted, you make another 1/1. You know, 3/3 definitely hits harder than 2/3. It also, you know, doesn't have that 6-mana ability though, but will this see too much play? I don't think so. Not now. But a couple of things. Yeah, it does work well with Proliferate. Yeah, that's true. It does work really well with Proliferate. And Sway, how you were just talking about a little bit ago. Yeah, if we do have mono green devotion being a thing, if we do go back to Theros, we don't know what the fall set's going to be yet, but there's a lot of people that are kind of saying that the rumor is that we could be going back to Theros with the temples coming back, and the temples were from Theros, with them coming back in this core set here, and with all these cavaliers having triple mana cost for like devotion purposes. So yeah, if we go back to something like that, then Barkhide Troll could be a better 2-drop there. You said Mark Rosewater said there will be a new plane. Oh well, and then so much there. But yeah, it does pair with Evolution Sage and everything. So overall, not a bad card. Pretty good rate here. So I think I'm going to go ahead and give this a D. So you're saying you think it's a solid D plus? I think it's kind of like a solid D. I think it's like, you know, Soul Diviner, Davriel, Evolution Sage. Those are cards that I gave D. It's a solid card. And that's the thing. It's like, my rating scale system is difficult, as you can tell here. Like, this is a good, solid card that will probably see some play, and I'm calling it a D. I'm a pretty difficult grader here. All right, we have Brightwood Tracker, 3 and a green, 2/4 Elf Scout. You can pay 6 mana and tap it. Look at the top 4 cards of your library. You may reveal a creature card from among them and put it into your hand. Put the rest on the bottom of your library in any order. This is, of course, put it into play. I would be much more excited about this, but it's put it into your hand. And it's also a 4-mana 2/4 that, you know, can draw a card if you pay 6 mana to draw a card. Not going to be good enough for standard for how good cards are these days. So we're going with an L limited rating. All All right, Cavalier of Thorns. 2 green for a 5/6 reach. When Cavalier of Thorns enters the battlefield, reveal the top 5 cards of your library, put a land card from among them onto the battlefield, and the rest into your graveyard. When Cavalier of Thorns dies, you may exile it. If you do, put another target card from your graveyard on top of your library. This card, I think, I really like this card. So, yeah, I'm really liking this card, kind of reading through this. So, it has the ability of that 3-mana 1/1, whatever name of that card is. But, yeah, look at the top 5 cards of your library, put a land from among them onto the battlefield. Love that. Like, Standard's all about, you know, like, getting extra mana, and especially the green decks. The green decks just want a lot of mana. All of the green decks in the format, you know, yeah, like your Command the Dreadhorde type deck. Yeah, even your Arcbow deck wants extra mana. Your Mass Manipulation deck, you know, Hydroid Krasis, you want a lot of mana. This is a good mid-game body. A 5/6 reach is, you know, a really big creature. And it gets you an extra land. You know, it's basically draw a card and put that card into play. You know, like with, like, draw a card and get a land drop. Like, that's a really good ability. It's an underrated ability. The next key part is the other 5 cards. They go to your graveyard. That works really well with, of course, like Tamiyo. You know, if you had Tamiyo on turn 4, you have Cavalier of Thorns here on turn 5 to protect the Tamiyo kind of thing. Or you know, like earlier with mana creatures, but that's your 4 into 5. Then you get to put cards in your graveyard that you can, like, then with Tamiyo grab back kind of thing afterwards. Gives you more targets there. Of course, Command the Dreadhorde, as we talked about. Like, Command the Dreadhorde is, you know, you just want to be filling your graveyard. This does that. You know, Find Finality. Like, this card works, you know, pretty well with Find Finality. Put some creatures over there so you get to find them back kind of thing. But that extra mana is definitely valuable. And, yeah, 5/6 reach. No, it doesn't have trample, but, you know, it's a big creature they're going to have to block all the time. Or if they kill it, then you exile your Cavalier of Thorns and put another target card from your graveyard on top of your library. So you can put, like, your Mass Manipulation, put your Command the Dreadhorde, you know, like, whatever, you know, if you milled any of those over, put those back on top. These green midrange decks with Krasis, Command, Manipulation, they want to be doing they want to be playing those all the time. When you get to, like, that, you know, when you get to, like, Mass Manipulation mana, you want to play your Mass Manipulation one turn, and then you want to play it again the next turn, and you want to play it again the next turn. Like, that's basically all you want to be doing. Kind of the same thing, like, Krasis chaining together for more Krasises, that kind of stuff. You know, also, like, if you find Nissa, put Nissa back on top. But, yeah, same with Command the Dreadhorde. You cast that, bring a bunch of stuff back. When they die, you want to Command the Dreadhorde again. This just kind of fits with all the stuff that the green decks are doing, honestly. And, yeah, you have Reach also. And the new 4-mana Vivian, if you're going with more of a beatdown plan with the 4-mana Vivian, you put some counters on this, give it trample also. This is just a good, solid card. I really like this one. This is exactly what green is trying to do. I think this is kind of an underrated card from the set. That putting lands into play, you know, if you keep on doing it, like, that's a really good, really good ability. So I like this Cavalier of Thorns. I think this is my second favorite Cavalier to the blue one, I think. So a B is a role player that sees play among multiple decks. And yeah, I see this being that. Maybe even a little better. Like, this is a like, I could even see, like, think about, like, Nexus decks. This could be, like, your side, like, instead of Biogenic Ooze in your sideboard, what if you play this in your sideboard kind of thing? Is, like, how you want to bring in, like, a creature, because, like, in, like, the Nexus kind of style decks, where, like, this is your creature that it also ramps you, which that deck just wants a whole lot of mana, and then it also, you know, mills over some cards that you put back on top. Like, if the Cavalier dies, you go put your Tamiyo back on top or whatever. So, yeah. Oh, the land enters untapped? Ooh, I didn't even realize that, to be honest. And yeah, especially how we're going with temples. So, like, this works really well with temples, of course. Putting, you know, like, if you don't have use for that extra one mana, you put a temple into play. And the temple scries, and so you help set up your next turn also. And everything. Yeah, maybe it doesn't replace ooze, but it can, like, you know, you can kind of go harder into the creature part with ooze and Cavalier of Thorns. Just saying, it could fit there too. And 5/6 is a huge, huge body. I like this card. I'm going B plus. All right, Centaur Courser. Yeah, that could be a card I'm too high on. Centaur Courser is a 3-mana 3/3, not a standard card. So let's give this the limited. Give this the good old limited rating. All right, we have Elvish Reclaimer. 1-mana 1/2 gets +2/+2 as long as there are 3 or more land cards in your graveyard. And you can pay 2 and sacrifice a land, search your library for a land card, put it onto the battlefield tapped, then shuffle your library. I don't know what to do with this card yet. But that's a very strong ability, sacking a land, putting any other land into play. That's a very strong ability. And, you know, it's just a 1-mana card. You can't expect, like, too much from a 1-mana card. But, you know, the fact they can turn into a 3/4 and everything. This card is good. Yeah, it's definitely, yeah, it's good with the temples, for sure. Yeah, it's good with, yeah, Blast Zone, Lotus Field. You know, you can go find your lands that are like the creatures, you know, like the creature lands. Go put a bunch of creature lands into play. Go put a bunch of Field of Ruins into play if you're trying to Field of Ruin out your opponent. And like a green black, you know, Field of Ruin Assassin's Trophy kind of deck. The green black deck also, you know, I think you do have the green black trophy, or sorry, the green black temple in this set, so that works very well there. And yeah, later on it's a 1-mana 3/4, which is, you know, good rate. Even, you know, even just kind of thinning your deck, you know, like when you're sacrificing lands and putting other lands into play, you are thinning your deck. It's not much, but it's not zero. And especially, you know, you activate it 2-3 times, it's not zero. So, you know, it does help your draw steps also. Yeah, so maybe, yeah, like the mono green Tron style type deck, I think would like this to be able to go make sure to go find Field of Ruin or Blast Zone or things like that. Yeah. Pretty cool little card here. How, like this, yeah, like this will be a fun one to kind of play and kind of build around. Maybe a powerful card that sees play in fringe decks for our rating here, a C, which is a C, probably something like that for the Elvish Reclaimer. But it's a really cool little card here. Yeah, card's a C. I like it. All right, Feral Invocation is an L for limited. Two and a green enchantment. Enchant creature gets +2/+2. It has flash. That's kind of cool. That's a limited one. Ferocious Pup. Look at how ferocious that pup is. 3-mana 0/1 ETB. Make a 2/2 green wolf creature token. So is this card like an A or an A plus? I think that's like really where the debate's at. Yeah, maybe best card ever printed. That could be there. Yeah, it's kind of hard to go anything other than like A plus. As y'all know, my dog's name is Pup. Also, I have a dog named Pup. I have a dog named Puppy. And Puppy kind of looks like that ferocious pup right there. But yeah, awesome card. Where is it seeing play in standard? I don't know. Yeah, I don't know. You know, we can have like our Neoform Vanifar decks. They can go get the pup, sacrifice the pup, go get something else kind of thing. There's the new green. Yeah, there's a lot of wolf stuff in here in this set. That's right. Yeah, there's a lot of wolf. Yeah, there's a lot of wolf cards. That's right. Yeah, we have a lot of wolf cards in this set. By a lot, I mean some. A couple. One. So yeah, you know, it could work in your wolf deck with your Night Pack Ambusher and everything. It could work there. No sacking. All right, no sacrificing the pub. Sorry, my bad. So yeah, awesome card. Should I give it like the A or A plus rating, or should I give it a more realistic rating of, you know, like a D? It's one of my favorite cards in the set. It's an awesome card, but realistic letter grade for standard, it's a D. Yeah, D for Doggo. Totsumer, friend of pups. There we go. All right, this next card. I actually have not read this next card yet. Gargos, Vicious Watcher. Is this a cycle? There seems like a crazy... Like, there was the dragon that kind of looked like this, you know, with the, that was red, red, red. Was this a cycle that I wasn't really noticing was a cycle? And, you know, now we're on the last color. But anyway, 3 GGG, so 6 mana, 8/7 Vigilance. Hydra spells you cast cost 4 less to cast. What? Whenever a creature you control becomes the target of a spell, so not ability, just spells... Gargos, Vicious Watcher. We have Vicious Watchers and Ferocious Pups. Man, green is just... They're mean. We got the mean green here with these Ferocious Pups and Vicious Watchers. Anyway, whenever a creature you control becomes the target of a spell, Gargos fights up to one target creature you don't control. This isn't seeing play, right? Like, is there... There's not like an actual Hydra deck that's playing this thing, right? So like they have to target your thing with a spell, or no, you can target your own creature with a spell. So whenever a creature you control comes target of a spell, it could be your spell. All right, so you're playing like your own fight spell, and then Gargos, Vicious Watcher fights another thing. Yep, Bioessence. Oh, Krasis is a Hydra. Okay. Well, this is pretty good with Krasis. Well, it's definitely not... This isn't a B. That's way too high. I guess there are some Hydra spells you can actually cast and stuff. All right. I was going to be giving this an F. But I guess maybe it could see some play somewhere. A janky build around type card kind of thing. I'm going to give it a D. All right, maybe it actually sees some play in standard. Or, you know, obviously a fun deck. I don't think it's definitely not like a tier one competitive deck kind of thing, kind of card. But, you know, we could maybe put it in a deck that I play here on stream. We can get some Gargos action. No, I don't like it in Bant Ramp. No. No. I think I would rather play Carnage Tyrant. Or, you know, something else. All right, Gift of Paradise. So this is a card, of course, that's in standard right now. It sees an okay amount of play. 2 and a green enchant land. Whenever... Gift of Paradise ETBs, you gain 3 life, and the enchant land has tap, add 2 mana of any one color. It's an okay card. You know, it fits, it does its thing. It gains some life for like your really ramp heavy decks that need it and everything. I think it's probably just another D. We'll see a little bit of standard play. No, this is in standard. Yeah, I guess both are in standard. Yeah. All right, Greenwood Sentinel, one in a green Elf Scout, 2/2 vigilant creature. That is just for limited. So Elf for limited. Not standard. All right, Grove Cycle, one in a green instant target creature gets +3/+3 until end of turn, and then it also gets an additional +2/+2 until end of turn for each card named Growth Cycle in your graveyard. So the first one is +3/+3 for two mana, one more mana for Giant Growth, and then your second one is +5/+5. Just the kind of stuff that I don't think is going to be happening in standard. I'm going to go with L for limited for this card. I don't really see. I think if I had the choice between that and Giant Growth and Standard, I would probably be playing Giant Growth. I don't think the additional +2/+2 is worth the extra mana and worth the second time you play the card. Like, when you play a card like this, what you want it to do is to really break open the game by like that trick. And like, if you'd play a card like that. And so I'd rather have the one mana Giant Growth. All right, Healer of the Glade, one mana, 1/2 elemental. Whenever Healer of the Glade enters the battlefield, you gain 3 life. So yeah, this was the card that we were kind of talking about that could the with the red 2 mana elemental. But yeah, so this is a one mana, 1/2, gain 3 life. Do you even want this against red? If you're like, let's say you're a green ramp deck, and you're just trying to find something to, do some work against the red deck as a sideboard card. Are you playing this over Bond of Flourishing or over the 0/3 that puts a land into play whenever you play it? I think this goes in Bant Party Bus. I don't know about that. No, it doesn't die to Chain Whirler, but would you rather have that 0/3 that just comes into play and puts a land, like whenever it ETBs, you put a land into play? Hey, Emmanuel. Yeah, we're on green, as you can see the order here. This is our last color. We've gone through white, blue, black, red. Now we're on green, and then we'll do multicolor on the rest. But all the reviews are going to be up on the YouTube channel. In fact, all the other colors are already up on the YouTube channel, to be honest. But yeah, I think we'd rather have like the 0/3, the ramps. And red can go really long. It's not like just a gain 3 life spell is really hurting the red deck too much. Thanks, Royal Flush. All right, so giving the Healer of the Glade an L for limited. Speaking of limited cards, we got another one right here. What's up, Hawkeye? The Howling Giant, 7 mana for a 5/5 reach. When Howling Giant enters the battlefield, create 2/2 green wolf creature tokens. Cool card, but not one that I think is really for standard. All right, Leafkin Druid, 2 mana, 0/3, tap, add one, add a green. And then if you control four or more creatures, you add 2 green instead. Not a bad one. Am I playing this over Paradise Druid, Incubation Druid? Probably not. I don't think the Elemental Druid here with the Leafkin Druid, that is going to be any better there. Is this better than, yeah, is this better than Druid of the Cowl? Maybe. Maybe better than Druid of the Cowl. So yeah, let's go with maybe a D minus. There are a lot of good mana creatures in standard right now. Yeah, Druid of the Cowl being an elf is pretty important. Do I need Howling Giant for Wolf Tribal? No, you don't need this for Wolf Tribal. It just costs too much. What are you doing? Okay. Sorry. All right. Leyline of Abundance. 2GG enchantment. You know, this is one of the ley lines, so it's going to start on the battlefield. If Leyline of Abundance is in your opening hand, you may begin the game with it on the battlefield. Whenever you tap a creature for mana, add an additional green. So every mana creature that you have now taps for an additional mana. So not only do you have to like have, for Leyline of Abundance to do anything, not only do you like have to have it like on, like in your opening hand, so it starts the game on the battlefield, because this is not really a card you're going to want to be playing later on. But then after that, then you also have to have your mana creatures after that. So like if you have like Leyline Abundance in your opener, but you don't have mana creatures in your opener, then like what are, you know, what's this Leyline really doing there? And it's just such a bad card to draw later on. I mean, I guess it does have like the eight, you know, it has a Shalai activation for 8 mana instead of 6. What are you doing? Yeah, it does make the Nissa Forest give you 3 mana, yes, because you're tapping a creature for mana. So yeah, Nissa Forest would get you an extra mana there too. Yeah, so this is definitely a high roll type card. But are we actually putting this in our 75? I don't think so. Yeah, I don't think so. I'm going with an F. I don't think there's any like a reason to put this in the deck. Like you would have to have, I don't know, if you have like what, 16 mana creatures? Maybe. But then you're playing the 4 ley lines also? I don't know. Yeah. I'm going F. All right, Loaming Shaman. Used to be a rare, now an uncommon. I feel like I was starting a rhyme there, which that wasn't my plan, but. All right, Loaming Shaman is a 2 green for a 3/2. When Loaming Shaman enters the battlefield, target player shuffles any number of target cards from their graveyard into their library. Good graveyard hate for a creature. You know, it's a good one if you're playing like a Collected Company type thing, or maybe a Vivian's Arcbow. You know, like you're getting your creatures into play. And yeah, you get to choose like, you know, how many cards. You know, it's a pretty good card against Command the Dreadhorde. You know, it's only target players. You can only do one, but you can also target yourself if you're playing against like a Command the Dreadhorde deck, and they don't really have stuff in their graveyard, but you do. You can shuffle some of your stuff back in. You know, like I said, kind of good with Arcbow. Also, get yourself some more Arcbow targets back in the deck if you have like a bunch of creatures that are dead. You know, can kind of fill your library back up with creatures, kind of thing. And yeah, it's a centaur. That's kind of cool. Yeah, it's good with Vanifar and everything. And yeah, of course, Arclight Phoenix. Yeah, definitely there. Yeah, Sothian, you're good there. Go ahead. You choose the cards, right? Yeah, you choose the cards. So like, yeah, you target the cards, your opponent doesn't, kind of thing. How this works. Like, but you can only choose from one person. So like you're telling target player to shuffle any number of target cards from their graveyard into their library. The reason why it says target players, so it's not just like both players. But you can only choose from one person. Yeah. So that's how that works. So you know, this seems like a pretty decent sideboard card. Could also be like a main deck green card kind of thing. Even like, you know, if you're playing like best of one, this could be like a green creature, I suppose. But Yeah, it's a pretty decent card here. Is it wonderful? No, but is it better than Deathgorge Scavenger? Absolutely. Like, this is a lot better green creature to affect graveyards than Deathgorge Scavenger is. Absolutely. And yeah, you can get your Ilharg's back and stuff. Yeah, if it's a late game, putting like, if this is like a real late game, putting like 8, 10 like spells that, are not lands, putting them all back like into your library and shuffling them back up can certainly help you out there. So let's see. I think we're gonna go with like a C, kind of a fringe sideboard card kind of thing. Maybe a little better than that. Maybe let's go like C plus. I don't know if we've given like many cards a C pluses so far. Let's give a C plus. This is a reprint. Yes, it used to be a rare. The first time it was printed, it was a rare. And so now that it got moved down to uncommon. All right, Mammoth Spider, 4 and a green, 3/5 reach. I'm gonna reach on over here and hit L for limited. Might of the Masses. This card is sneaky. So it's just 1 green mana. Target creature gets +1/+1 until end of turn for each creature you control. That can be a lot of pluses. If you're playing a creature deck that's going real wide, this can kill people out of nowhere. It's an instant, you attack with a bunch of creatures, they block something, you say like 1 green mana, give your creature +7/+7, get +8/+8, kind of thing like that. It's the kind of card that you're gonna die to in Constructed, and you're gonna be like, what? Why are they playing Might of the Masses? The heck, nobody plays that card. Naya Feather, no. Not the no. Or wait, the Naya Feather, sorry. Naya Feather with Hero Precinct 1. I was kind of just thinking, but yeah. If you're going like Hero Precinct 1 and trying to go wide with something like that, maybe. But yeah, Selesnya Tokens type deck. Just like mono green, like budget. Like, this is a really good budget card, like for budget decks, like budget mono green aggro kind of thing with like mana creatures and big creatures. And you maybe make something trample and then boom, Might of the Masses just kills you. Is this already in standard right now? Yeah, Krenko. Oh man, this is the card for Krenko. Are you sure this is already in standard right now? I don't think it is. It is. It's definitely a reprint. I mean, yeah, we've played Might of the Masses multiple times, but yeah, I didn't think it was in standard. It's not. Nope. Okay. So yeah, I'm gonna go with like, I'm not gonna just go with an F here. Let's go. I guess we just go with the D. Do I want to go minus or plus? No, I'll just go with like a D. It's in standard. It's in Guilds of Ravnica. D minus. Yeah, like, yeah, you just checked. It's in Guilds of Ravnica. Okay. But yeah, like I said, it's a good budget card. It's not something that goes to like the top tier standard decks or anything, but it's a good budget card. All right, Natural End. We have a lot of reprints in the set, but that's a core set. Lots of reprints. These next two cards are reprints. 3 mana instant, destroy target artifact or enchantment, gain 3 life. I think I'd rather be playing Naturalize most of the time, even though you don't get to gain 3 life, but it costs 1 less. I mean, maybe if like all your other artifact and enchantment hate rotate for some reason, then you have this in your sideboard. So hey, what's up, Drew Money? Thanks for that resub there. So this is probably just an F, but it could go D minus also. I'll just go F. This is not a card I'm ever gonna put in any sideboard. Yeah, I'm never gonna make a sideboard with this card in it. All right, Netcaster Spider, 2 and a green, 2/3 reach. Whenever it blocks a creature with flying, it gets +2/+0 until end of turn. pretty good limited card. I drafted this one quite a bit in limited and whatever other format it used to be in. Definitely remember taking a bunch of these. So that's a limited one. All right, what about the Night Pack Ambusher? 2GG, 4/4 flash. Other wolves and werewolves you control get +1/+1. At the beginning of your end step, if you didn't cast a spell this turn, create a 2/2 green wolf creature token. So, a couple of ways to play this. One is, of course, Vivian's Arcbow is like the most obvious thing, where you don't need to cast spells on your turn with Vivian's Arcbow. You just activate your Arcbow, put stuff into play. Your Night Pack Ambushers are just getting you wolves each time. 4/4 body is pretty nice for 4. Works very well with Frilled Mystic. Also in that Vivian's Arcbow deck where you want other flash creatures because you don't want to play stuff on your turn. So you want other flash creatures. You can play stuff on their turn. Like a blue-green flash deck. And then, of course, besides that, yeah, if you just want like a wolf tribal deck, if you want some wolves, we have our wolf from our last set, War of the Spark, not Tristani, the other one that's not Tristani, that's a wolf that makes other wolves. No, not Arlan. The one that makes Tulsimer. There you go. Tulsimer. Yeah. So this could work with Tulsimer also, because then you make a 4/4 wolf that comes in and fights and gains 3 life. You make a couple 4/4s because they'd get +1/+1. I do like how the Night Pack Ambusher here isn't legendary, so they do get to stack if you get a good amount of them. And flash is a really powerful keyword. Now, flash hasn't been less valuable than it is right now with Little Teferi, but flash is still a really powerful keyword. Little Vivian probably works pretty well in like this Night Pack Ambusher deck if you want to like have your other creatures have flash also, so you can just kind of like Little Vivian is another way to try to play at the opponent's turn all the time also. So yeah, y'all are saying B-. I'm liking that grade. Yeah, I'm liking that grade. A B minus here, maybe a C plus. Maybe it's closer. Man, I gave Bolas a Citadel a C whenever I was just doing these. I maybe gave some of these C's and D's that, like for the examples, a little bit too low of a grade. Bolas Citadel, sweet. But you know, is this really that much better than Bolas Citadel? It's kind of hard. But yeah, good in Arcbow, good in like a few different decks though. Like you can play this in different things, and I like it. All right, C plus. Overcome, 3GG sorcery. Creatures you control get +2/+2 and gain trample until end of turn. That's just a limited card, we'll go L. Overgrowth Elemental. Whenever it enters the battlefield, put a 1/1 counter on another target elemental you control. Whenever another creature you control dies, you gain 1 life. If that creature was an elemental, put a 1/1 counter on Overgrowth Elemental. You would really have to be heavy elemental deck, like, you know, like red-green elementals to play this card. I don't think that from reading all the red cards that were the elemental stuff also and this, I don't think there's really a payoff for going elementals, going hard and playing these cards, to be honest. I don't like this card. Nissa lands, of course, are elementals. Those are good. And of course, Chandra is good, like 3 mana Chandra. But I think that those cards are just really good, and it's just probably better to put better cards in your deck than putting this Overgrowth Elemental in your deck. Is it's possible Wildgrowth Walker is an elemental. Yeah, probably is. So yeah, I think just put better cards in the deck instead of just focus on elemental stuff. All right, so I'm going to give that an L for a limited rating. Plummet We'll give Plummet the D minus. It's an okay sideboard card. Destroy target creature with flying. There's kind of a better one that was just printed to have put a creature with flying onto the bottom of its owner's library. That one's just gonna kind of be better than just destroy. So yeah, there are good cards that are elementals, but there's not really a reason to put this in your deck because you're playing good cards that are elementals. Okay, 3 mana, 3/2, put a counter on one of those other cards, and then gain a life every time one of your creatures dies, and then sometimes this creature gets a little bit bigger. It's just not a very good card. It's really not. So I gave Overcome the limited rating. I mean, this is like, realistically, this could be a finisher in a green white token style deck. You know, like if you're trying to be like a token kind of deck or something. Or I guess if you're playing like a mono green stompy and you want to give your creatures +2/+2 and trample. I don't think it's really worth it though, but you can, as far as like the green white tokens, I would kind of rather just have Unbreakable Formation that costs 2 less and can do other things. Plus you have Flower Flourish also. I don't know if you need another one of those kind of cards with Overcome. All right, Pulse of Murasa. 3 mana instant, 2 energy. Return target creature or land card from a graveyard to its owner's hand. You gain 6 life. This card is pretty sweet. Gaining 6 life is a lot of life. Very good for like a blue-green ramp deck or a green ramp deck against the red decks. Yeah, gain 6 life. You do need a creature or a land in your graveyard to cast this, though. You can't just cast it and gain 6. You know, you can't just do that because you do have to target something here. So that's a little bit of a downside. But, you know, we were just talking about like the Green Cavalier, how that card's pretty good. Tameo. You know, like there's a lot of cards that like, you know, help fill your graveyard kind of thing. And this Pulse of Murasa, you know, gets something back in the late game, gets you something really good back, and also gain 6. It's good with Lotus Field that puts lands. Yeah, it's really good with Lotus Field. Get one of the lands back, gain 6. You know, Krasis is a great card to get back, like in a ramp deck in the late game. I think this is mostly a sideboard card. This card has definitely seen main deck play before. Whenever, like the last time I was in the format. It kind of depends on your deck. You have to really be kind of building around your graveyard by quite a bit here for Pulse of Murasa. Field of Ruin. Field of Ruin's a good one. Bolas's Citadel. Ooh, this is awesome with Bolas's Citadel. This is very good there. So this could be a main deck card for Bolas's Citadel. Yeah, like that quite a bit there. So let's go, are we going to go D plus or C minus here? 6 is a lot of life. It really is. Yeah, like that's a lot of life. Let's go with like a C minus here. Yeah, let's go C minus. Because I am kind of liking this black-green... like Field of Ruin, like, you know, black green land destruction, Assassin's Trophy, a bunch of, you know, 4 Assassin's Trophy, 4 Field of Ruin, kind of style deck where I kind of want to play some Pulse of Murasa in that to, yeah, get your Field of Ruins back, the Green Cavalier, to help ramp a little bit, Casualties of War, this card, you know. You sack your land, put whatever utility land into play. The Pulse of Murasa gets your utility land back kind of thing. Get this card, because there's going to be 12 duels now with green-black, with having the scry lands in green-black. So I really like having those scry lands there. Yeah. Yeah, not too shabby. Yeah, it's basically, yeah, draw a card plus gain 6 life for 3 mana. Not so bad. All right, Rabid Bite is one in a G sorcery. This thing's in standard. Target creature you control deals damage equal to its power to target creature you don't control. This is a card that you'll like run into every now and again, that, you know, kind of budget green removal kind of thing. It's not the worst. I'm going to go ahead and give it a D minus. We won't just give it just a strictly L limited rating. This is the kind of thing you'll just run into. This has the best art in the game. A guy bites a werewolf. I haven't really looked at the picture too much. I just honestly never really noticed the werewolf's face here. It looks so surprised. I never really, you know, noticed that there. Oh, certainly going to play 4X Temple in a two-color deck. The Temples... We'll talk about the Temples more later when we get to them. But yeah, the two-color decks, I'm playing 4X for sure. All right, Season of Growth. One in a green enchantment. Whenever a creature enters the battlefield under your control, scry one. And whenever you cast a spell that targets a creature you control, draw a card. Does Feather even want this? So, you know, you have your creature out, and plus you have like your spells that target it out. Like you're doing both of those. You're already doing your thing with your deck. Do you need the Season of Growth that's in play also? Or are there going to be times, like, if you play Season of Growth, it also just, it's another card that dilutes your deck. So is there just going to be too many times where you just have, like, lands and Season of Growth and pump spells and, you know, and you just don't have your creatures kind of thing? Or you just have your lands and your creatures and then your Season of Growth and you don't have your spells to target stuff? While it does, like, when you already have, you know, part A and, like, you need, let's say X and Y. You need X and Y for your Feather deck to work. And when you already have X and Y, Season of Growth makes your deck even better. But it's something that's not X and it's not Y. And it only works when you already have X and Y, like, when you need them both. It's like, do you want this card in your deck? Do you want extra filler, basically, extra... Or, like, I guess, like, water. It waters down your deck, I guess, kind of thing. It only draws cards when you have X and Y, when you have creatures and spells to cast to target your creatures, kind of thing. It's definitely not more than a one of. But, yeah, is the first copy, is that going to be good enough? Do you... even need to play green kind of for this card? I'm not sure. Like, those are questions that we'll have to answer. And, you know, I'm just kind of putting questions out there. But yeah, it is a consideration as a one-up for sure. So I don't want to just shut it down completely, but that's what you kind of have to think about whenever we're putting this card in the deck. It's probably like where you just kind of try it as a one-up to start with and kind of see how it goes, I guess. That's where we're kind of at. So for a rating, I'm not going to just give it just a limited rating. Let's go with a D for the Season of Growth. Maybe a D minus, because it's really not going to be more than a one of, for the most part. Pulsar Mirasa, I gave it a C minus. I like Pulsar Mirasa. Sedge Scorpion, 1 mana, 1/1, Death Touch. Good flavor text. Thakalides the Mighty, Slayer of Minotaurs, Vanquisher of Giants, killed by a scorpion. This didn't see any standard play really the first time. This could be a sideboard card though. This could be like against a green. Like, if green creature decks get like a boost because of like Vivian kind of thing. If like big green creature decks get kind of a boost and you're playing like a green ramp deck, like a blue green ramp deck, and you want this as your side in your sideboard for like removal, for like basically one mana removal for like other green creature decks. Yeah, the Scorpion was in Theros. Yeah. Maybe it could do something there. So very, very fringe sideboard card. It's getting the D minus here. Shared summons. 3GG instant. Search your library for up to 2 creature cards with different names. Reveal them, put them into your hand, then shuffle your library. Last set we had Ignite the Beacon. That was 4 and a white. Search your library for 2 planeswalker cards. Put them into your hand. That card didn't really come close to ever seeing play whatsoever. And I don't really see this card either. It's a 5-mana... Yeah. 5-mana double tutor creatures. It's a lot of mana. Yeah, if you have a combo deck, if you have like a creature combo deck for sure. You know, if you want to play it against control and go grab your Shifting Ceratops and your Carnage Tyrant, or maybe grab your like Cavalier and your Hydroid Krasis. I mean, it's good with Hydro. There's cards that go get you Hydroid Krasis, I guess can't be that bad, right? If it was 1G and you got 1 creature, that'd be awesome. Yeah, if it's 2GG, you get your 2, awesome. But yeah, 5 is a lot. To like just take an entire turn off, especially in the mid game there in standard, taking an entire turn off is kind of rough. in limited, you forget what creatures you have. I'm going to go with D for shared summons. Janky build around if there's like, you know, a combo deck that kind of surfaces kind of thing. Yeah, maybe a Frilled Mystic type deck. Like maybe this blue-green flash kind of deck with Frilled Mystics and Night Pack Ambushers. If you like, you know, you don't need to really play anything, you go grab a Night Pack Ambusher and a Frilled Mystic. I don't know. All right, Shifting Ceratops. 2GG, 5/4, can't be countered, protection from blue, and then you can also pay a G to give Shifting Ceratops reach, trample, or haste. Oh, yeah, shared summon. Yeah, you go grab Spark Double Ancillae. There you go. B plus sideboard in every green deck against control also replaces Rekindling Phoenix in the 4-drop slot after rotation. Is this really that good? Against control? Sure, it can't be countered, but the can't be countered clause has basically no value. What counter spells are people playing? Nobody's playing counter spells. You already have Domries that say your spells can't be countered. There's Lil Teferi. Like, the only counter spells that are being played right now are Dovin's Vetoes and Negates. Nobody's trying to counter creatures. Like Esper's not countering anything. Like, the only spells that are getting countered are, like, actually spells. They're not creatures. Well, you don't want to block Lyra because Lyra has first strike. But yeah, so you can haste it. So it can be so 5-mana, 5/4 haste. Like that's a whole lot worse than the red creature that has haste and trample, the 5/5 haste dino. You know, a 5/4 that doesn't have trample. Like this just gets blocked by Hero of Precinct 1 tokens against Esper decks these days. But the control decks just have removal. You know, like they'll just play Dispark or Cast Down, you know, or whatever. They just you just kill this with removal. It's a very easy card to kill with removal. The protection from blue basically just means that Teferi's can't bounce it, and like that Tyrant Scorn can't bounce it. But that's kind of whatever. Like the removal spells aren't really blue. Protection from blue is not that valuable. Yeah, can't be. I guess Enter the God Eternals. I suppose that one can't kill it. If it was just a 5/5 anyway, it wouldn't be able to die. I don't really see this card being that good. Like I don't see wanting to play this in my green decks, in my green creature decks, honestly. Maybe I'm way too low on this card. The haste protects against Teferi, but at that point it's a 5-mana card with haste. And yes, it's good against Teferis, but what if they like, so you get to like 5-mana haste it, but then if they also just have like Hero Precinct 1, or if they just untapped their two lands with Teferi and have Cast Down or Dispark. Or, it's also just, I don't know. It's kind of meh. Yeah, maybe we played in like the green-red dinos, maybe. I mean, I'd rather, like, Regisaur Alpha seems pretty good, making, like, another creature that's a 3-3 that has haste. I do like that you can give it trample afterwards, like, later on. Yeah, I don't think you're really giving it haste and trample right away, but you do have, like, those abilities, too. In case you can add more mana with, like, Domries and stuff like that, and mana creatures. But yeah, very, very vulnerable. Yeah, Lava Coil, Cast Down, all that kind of stuff. Yeah, I'm not very, very high on this card. I'm kind of thinking this is just like a D, a card that we'll sometimes see in standard, but underpowered. Blocks Drakes, yeah. And the Drake decks will just Lava Coil this. So they always have a bunch of Lava Coils. Yeah, pro blue is just is like the least, that's the least valuable protection color, like just in standard. That's the least valuable one. I'm just giving it a D, because you can give it, you can spend a mana to give it reach to block a Drake, kind of thing. Yeah, I'd much rather have Nullhide Ferox, definitely. Yeah, just not very big on this card at all. So why would this card have to be good if Carnage Tyrant is good? Because this card dies to Lava Coil and Cast Down and Dispark and a whole bunch of 2-mana removal spells. Where Carnage Tyrant doesn't die to any removal spell. It has Hexproof. And while this thing, while Carnage Tyrant has trample all the time, you have to like spend mana to try to give this thing trample. If they play like a Gruul Spellbreaker, you know, their Gruul Spellbreaker is going to trade with this four mana card, their 3-mana card will. Yeah. I basically, right now, this spell can't be countered, is just not valuable, and protection from blue is a little valuable, but it's the worst protection color. But, you know, it's good against specifically Teferi that can't bounce it. That's kind of about it. Doesn't get mass manipulationed, I suppose. Silverback Shaman. 5-mana, 5/4, trample. When Silverback Shaman dies, draw a card. Silverback Shaman that much worse than this shifting Ceratops? I don't know, they're pretty similar. This is not a very good card. This is not a very good card either. All right, so that one's an L. All right, Thicket Crasher, 4 mana, 4/3 trample. Other elemental creatures you control have trample. Yeah, we're not really playing this Thicket Crasher at all either. All right, that's gonna be another L. Do you think any of the knights slash Big Chandra is decent in Grixis? Yeah, I like Big Chandra a lot. That card's very good. For Grixis, Grixis is like maybe one of the decks that it's worse in, but yeah, it's still definitely good in Grixis there. Very good in like control mirrors. The sweeper effect can be beneficial, but Big Chandra like shooting down other planeswalkers and that plus, I really like the plus two and the minus X with Big Chandra a lot. Thrashing Brontodon, awesome card, very good sideboard card. You know, big body for 3 mana, get a 3/4 there, and you know, obviously destroying artifacts, enchantments, valuable. What are we giving this card? I guess fringe sideboard card, C. Maybe a little bit better than fringe sideboard cards, maybe C plus. Yep, Brontodon does die to removal, but it also costs 3 mana to die to Lava Coil, not 4 mana to die to Lava Coil. And this destroys Frenzy. This doesn't destroy Frenzy. Nope, no destroying Frenzy over there. All right, Veil of Summer. G, instant. Draw a card if an opponent has cast a blue or black spell this turn. Okay, pretty nice there. Let's see what else it say. Spells you control can't be countered this turn. All right, that's not that valuable, but whatever. You and permanents you control gain hexproof from blue and black this turn. Okay, now we're talking. So you and your permanents not only gain hexproof from blue and black, black being the color that really matters there, and it cycles and you draw a card. So great sideboard card here. Obviously not a main deck card, but awesome sideboard card here against Esper. Like, let's say you're on the draw. You go forest, go. Your opponent played like Watery Grave on turn one. And then they play Hallowed Fountain or whatever, Glacial Fortress, and then they just cast Thought Erasure. You just get to counter their Thought Erasure for 1 mana and draw a card. Oh, that is big game right there. Yeah. Such a great card against Thought Erasure. Great card against, you know, all the other blue and black cards that target. Yeah, Mass Manipulation. You know how, like, I've definitely, you know, like, I have, like, we talked about, like, when I was playing Team or Hydra before, you know, I'm playing, like, these really big Bioessence Hydras, and, like, the steel effects were just so hard for me to deal with. Boom, here's the card, Veil of Summer. Awesome sideboard card here. Love it. I think this is going to be a B, very popular sideboard card. That's what we give Bs around here. Very common sideboard card, like Dovin's Veto and stuff. Perfect B here. I am a big fan of Veil of Summer. Love it. Yeah, so give me that card all day long. All right, Vivian Arcbow Ranger. 1GGG for 4 loyalty planeswalker. So 4 mana, 4 loyalty, but you need to be heavy green because that's a tough mana cost, as we've seen with the Jace from War of the Spark. Legendary planeswalker Vivian. Distribute plus one, distribute 2/1/1 counters among one or two target creatures. They gain trample until end of turn. That is an awesome plus one ability. Like a Johnny Adversary of Tyrants has that plus one, put 2/1/1 counters on your creatures, and that ability is awesome, and I have won so many games with a Johnny and ticking up and everything. And this is just strictly better because you get to choose if you want to target two creatures, or if you just have the one creature in play, you can put two counters on just that one creature also. And then also that creature gains trample until end of turn. That is big time. Trample is a really, really nice keyword to have, especially with a bunch of green creatures that have some nice power and toughness stats already. And after you put counters on them, makes it even better. Really, really nice plus one. Love that plus one there. Yeah, Nullhide Ferox, absolutely. Kind of thing. All right, then you have the minus three. Target creature you control deals damage equal to its power to target creature or planeswalker. Okay. You know, like if you want to do like your Rabid Bite kind of thing, or your Domri's Ambush, or your Thrash. I guess Thrash is the one that this is technically Thrash. But yeah, it's definitely a valuable thing. You know, like they have like a planeswalker at six or whatever. You have your Nullhide Ferox, you minus three, your Nullhide Ferox deals damage over there. But yeah, it's also, you know, removal. They have their own creature. It's kind of like a three mana Domri that like has your creatures fight, but this, it just deals damage. It doesn't fight. So then can also attack afterwards into another smaller creature. Yeah, and against planeswalkers. So yeah, good minus three ability there. And then minus five, you may choose a creature card you own from outside the game, reveal it, and put it into your hand. Okay, we have a little bit of a weird minus five here. So it's talking about your sideboard. So you can minus five and get creatures out of your sideboard. I don't expect to do that very much. You can get like a Carnage Tyrant from your sideboard, but for the most part, like let's say you play Vivian and you tick up and you get to five loyalty, and the next turn you minus five, you're cashing in your Vivian at that point. And so you're basically cashing in your Vivian for a creature. Like, that just, you know, it's taking away your Vivian. That's not great. But it does have just, like, some flexibility. Yeah, you can have Carnage Tyrants in your sideboard. You can have, like, a Galta in your sideboard for whenever you're, you know, like, make it good for, you know, like, there's definitely matchups that you really want Galta in whenever you already have a big battlefield presence against, like, other decks that aren't really doing removal. Like, they're playing, like, their creatures. You're playing your creatures. And, then you can cash in your Vivian for a Galta. It does put it into your hand. So like if you're playing like an Ilharg deck, for example, you can go put whatever you want in your hand, Ilharg attack, put it into play kind of thing. But yeah, Ripjaw Raptor could be a good one for you there. Yeah, Ronus kind of thing. The problem is like the more creatures that you put in your sideboard like that, the more you're diluting your sideboard, and like the less like real spells you're gonna have like in your sideboard that you're gonna really want, you know cards like Veil of Summer that you're gonna want in your sideboard kind of thing. So like I don't expect to actually activate that minus five too often, but that, you know, it's a nice ability to have. The plus one and the minus three are really good, especially the plus one, very good. Definitely like that there. And yeah, not a good point there, Storm. Not everybody plays best of three. This card is awesome in best of one. Best of one, you get to fill your sideboard with creatures. That's where I kind of, yeah, that's whenever I read that the first time, that's what I was kind of thinking, that it's kind of built for best of one there, like mono green best of one, basically. That's what this is really built for. Yeah, I think this could make Green Stompy look really good in Best of One, honestly. Because Best of One is all about trying to beat Mono Red and Esper, and this Vivian could be like the card that Mono Green Stompy was really looking for to try to, you know, to be able to help him beat Mono Red and Esper. You know, it's specifically the Esper part of that scenario in Best of One. So yeah, pretty cool looking card here. I like this Vivian a whole lot. Definitely excited to play this. I love playing large creatures and putting counters on my creatures and attacking and everything like that. you know, again, the GGG is a little rough. Really wish it was two colorless GG. Certainly wish it was that, but if you're going to be triple colored, green is probably a good color to be triple colored because you're playing like Land of War Elves and other mana creatures like that, where it's not too difficult to get to three green there. So yeah, y'all are saying like B, C plus, B plus. I'm liking a B plus. I'm liking that grade. Good old B plus here. I like it. All right, B plus. Good card. If you're playing like Sultai, you know, you can have Vivian go find Hostage Taker kind of thing. Like, you can get some kind of pretty decent creatures like that you'd want in your sideboard anyway that Vivian could wish for. It's a green Power Ranger. I get it. Green Power Ranger. Okay, I get it. The Green Power Ranger. All right. I'm picking up what you're putting down. All right, we got the Voracious Hydra up next. XGG01 Trample. Voracious Hydra enters the battlefield with X11 counters on it. And whenever it enters the battlefield, you can choose one. You can either double the number of 1-1 counters on Voracious Hydra or have Voracious Hydra fight target creature you don't control. Not a bad card. Not a bad card. So, like, you spend 6 mana on this Voracious Hydra, you get a 4-5 trample, or I guess you either get an 8-9 trample, or you get a 4-5 that fights another target creature you don't control. Kind of thing. Those are both, like, pretty decent. I mean, if we kind of want to make our janky Hydra deck, you know, of course, with this other Hydra to make your Hydras cost 4 less, you know, you can put that together. Is this better than other options in Standard? Probably not. Like, green has a lot of good things to ramp into, you know, like with Krasis and everything. But it kind of, it's like Ravager Worm is really good, and this is kind of Ravager Worm. It's Ravager Worm-ish. That's what I'm kind of like picturing Ravager Worm with this card. It's a Ravager Worm that has trample instead of haste, but also doesn't have ride. It's like Ravager Worm with haste as a 4-5. This is a 4-5 for 6 mana that has trample instead, but it also, you know, just all the other kind of scaling that you can do with the card. It's, you know, like Ravager Worm, a strong part about that card, of course, is you get to put it into play with, like, Ilharg. You're not putting this card into play with Ilharg kind of thing. This is pretty good with Nissa. This seems like, I don't know, Trample's nice. Trample's a nice one. Like, this kind of seems like a pretty decent card to play with Vivian. So, like, let's say you spend 3 mana. So, 3 mana, it's a 2-2, or it's a 2-3. Trample, then you start trying to grow with Vivian at 4, that then adds another counter to it. It's not so strong, but I guess, you know, like late game it can be really, really big. There's a lot of good cards in Standard. I don't know if Voracious Hydra really makes the cut, but it's not a bad card. It's not a bad one. So maybe a C minus or a D plus. We'll go C minus. Yeah. Removal with green creatures is always nice to have. And Voracious Hydra can be that. Yeah, I do like the versatility that card has. there's not really any points where it's like absolutely perfect for like the fighting part, but yeah, I definitely like the fighting part. Hydras are always apt. All right, Vorst Claw, 6 mana, 7/7. This is just a limited card. Give it L for limited. Wake Root Elemental, 6 mana, 5/5. So just being a 6 mana, 5/5 with no keywords, that's not a good start. You can spend 5 mana to untap an all green mana to untap a land you control. It becomes a 5/5 elemental creature with haste. Yeah, I think this is just an F. I don't think we're gonna like even like the green, like, you know, green stompy decks, you're not playing this card. I would rather have the, like, in standard right now, there's a 6 mana 8/8 trampler that gives all your other creatures trample. Just give me that, or, you know, a lot of other cards that are a lot better. Sorry, Wake Root Elemental. Wolfkin Bond, 4 and a green enchant creature. When it enters the battlefield, create a 2/2 wolf creature token, and enchant creature gets +2/+2. This is an L for limited. There's like the white enchantment with the knights. Knightly Valor, I think is the name. Knightly Valor is like this 5 mana enchant creature, but then you make 2/2 knights and enchant creature gets +2/+2. So I don't know why this is only 1/2 wolf. Like, why isn't this 2/2 wolves? So it should be. All right, Wolf Rider's Saddle. Enters the battlefield, you make a 2/2 green wolf creature token, then attach the Wolf Rider's Saddle to it, and equipped creature gets +1/+1 and can't be blocked by more than one creature and has equipped 3. This is like my least favorite of these that I've seen so far, being 4 mana to make a 3/3 that can't be blocked by more than one creature and then having equipped 3. Yeah, at 4 mana, we need to be doing something better. So we'll just give this one the limited rating also. We're not playing this one in standard. And then Woodland Champion is a 2 mana 2/2 elf scooter. Whenever one or more tokens enter the battlefield under your control, put that many 1/1 counters on Woodland Champion. So I'm just trying to think if like green-white tokens would want to play this at all. Yeah, it doesn't have trample. It's like a Shauna, like Shauna Sisse Legacy. It's like Shauna, except for Shauna is good, like, whether you draw it early or late, and this is only good if you play this first and then start playing tokens afterwards. If you play this late, it's terrible. It's just a 2 mana 2/2. Nah. There's a cat. Cats are cool. I don't know why there's a cat with the Elf Scout. I don't really know. But now I'm going to just give that one the limited grade as well. All right, let's kind of go back through. Let's see what we gave our best grades to. So cards that we got B or higher. We got Vivian's Arcbow Ranger was a B+. Veil of Summer was a B. And we had one other card that was B or higher with green was Cavalier of Thorns being another B+. So I really like the two mythics here in green, Cavalier of Thorns and Vivian. I like both those mythics quite a bit. But yeah, so that's the color green. All right. So that concludes all the single color. So now we have multicolor artifacts and lands still to go. So if you're watching this video later on YouTube, hope you've been enjoying them. Please hit the like and subscribe buttons for all these videos. And head on over to our last video. And I'll see you there. Thanks for watching.